We're here this weekend. Actually, yesterday was a very special date for most people in America, April 15. You know what that means? Yeah, the tax man cometh. But a lot of people are also aware that very, very few times in the history has the Passover for the Jewish people, the 14th day of Ramadan for Islam, and for Christians, Good Friday. If you live in Boston, April 15 is also known as One Boston Day in remembrance of those tragic victims back 9 or 10 years ago. But we are gathered here this morning. By the way, I might just say this as I'm looking out. It is so good to see, to be in the physical presence of people. It's one thing to watch Randy Roberts, you know, on my flat screen at home, but to be with people, to be with God's people, just that's been a missing ingredient in many, many people's lives for the last couple of years. And I praise God that we can be together this morning. We are here this morning as Christian Seventh-day Adventists. Notice I said Christian first. I'm not a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. I'm a Christian Seventh-day Adventist, and there's a difference. But I won't go into that this morning. But here we are. We celebrate, whether you want to call it Resurrection Weekend, if you want to call it Easter, if you want to call it Holy Week, whatever you call it, we are here this morning to say thank you, Jesus, for the empty tomb. There's no other religion in the world that can talk about their risen Savior. Muhammad is gone. All the gods of Hinduism are gone. Thank you for the cross of Calvary, dear Jesus. Thank you for the crown of thorns. Thank you for those nails, those scars. Thank you that if I was the only reason for you to come to this earth, you'd have come for me. The one earthly reason was me, was you. You see, the cross says it all for Christians. Every week, I believe, should be a resurrection celebration for Christians everywhere, not just once a year. So this morning, I want us to focus on the main thing. I'm going to try to multitask this morning. So let's get that first graphic going there. Do I need to advance it? There we go. Title of my sermon this morning is The Main Thing Is... ... Pastor friend of mine, we used to have these ministerial huddles every month, and he was having some real challenges in his church, and one of my youth pastor friends shared with him a motto that he said, you need to adopt this for your church and for your life. And I listened to this motto, and I said, you know what, that's for me. And I've adopted this motto in my life. I pray you seriously consider adopting in your life and the life of this church. Now, you might want to get your pencils out, jot it down. It's a good one. But my motto is simply this. Jody, the main thing, our sermon title, Jody, the main thing is that the main thing is the main thing. Think about it. Make sure that the main thing is the main thing. What's this church all about? Why are we here? What's it all about? Our church here in Clearview, our church in North America, around the world, why are we here? I want to leave you with that thought just to push the pause button for a minute. And I want to refocus for just a little bit. Many of you are aware that I come from a family that grew up singing together. This is a picture that's taken 65 years ago. There's my brother Lonnie. There's me. And my little brother Rudy and Dallas and Eugene and my mom and dad. When we first started singing together as a family, this was in Springfield, Massachusetts. You know, for 65 years we blended. We took my mom and dad up to Canada a number of years ago before they passed away, and we went to the old farm and stood around the old tractor, and it is good. Five boys, 5 years and 8 months from youngest to oldest. So 4 months a year, we're stair steps. This is before the days of Pampers and automatic washers and dryers. My mom, believe me, she deserves a gold medal. But I tell you what, those five boys, no sisters, we were hyperactive. We were ADD before we knew the ADD was around. So it's our elementary and high school years. My dad was pastoring. Every Saturday night in our home, it was filled with young people and families. It was game night with the Meloshenkos. And mom had the popcorn going, the root beer floats, and pizza. Now, this is before the days of PlayStation or Nintendo. We knew nothing about internet games back then. The favorite games we played were Rook, Scrabble. My dad was an incredible word player. He loved word games. And Monopoly. Now, I know that for young people this day and age, it's hard for them to get the picture of you actually got to interact with real people, not some cyber dude halfway across the world, but you got to actually interact with real people. It's an experience that I'm sad to say has not really done our culture a lot of favors. But I'll leave that for another time. Like I said, my dad, Scrabble, Boggle, and he had a game called Anagrams. And if any of you ever know how, it's a very, very challenging game. And even up to a few weeks before he passed away, his mind was still sharp enough. I never beat him. I could never beat him. Amazing. Well, in his book, It All Goes Back in the Bach, the author, John R. Ortberg, describes a scene in his home that was very similar to what happened in the Meloshenko family. He describes a scene with his grandmother, who absolutely loved to play Monopoly. She didn't like to lose, and he describes his grandmother as one who was short, round, and soft, the way grandmas used to be before they took up aerobics. But she knew how to play the game. She understood that you don't win without risk. And so she'd spend every dollar buying every piece of property. She'd mortgage every piece of property to the hilt in order to buy everything else. And she understood what Johnny says, what I did not, that accumulating is the name of the game. That money is how you keep score. And grandma played with skill and passion and reckless abandon. And eventually, grandma would become what he called the master of the board. Now, when you're master of the board, you own so much property that no one can ever hurt you again. You're in control. Other players regard you with fear and awe. And from that point on, as Johnny describes, he said, it's only a matter of time. She'd watch me land on boardwalk one time too many, hand over what was left of my money, put my little race car marker away, all the time wondering why I had lost again. He said, I never won. Grandma said, oh, don't worry about it, Johnny. One of these days, you'll learn how to play the game. Ooh, he hated it when she said that. Well, wouldn't you know it? That summer, a little neighbor boy moves across the street, excuse me, little Stevie. And Steve loved Monopoly. And so they played every day. And Johnny finally learned that the only way to win is to make a total commitment to acquisition. No mercy, no fear. What grandma had been showing him for years finally sunk in. The summer has passed. Johnny couldn't wait for Grandma to show up at the house. It was a new school year. Grandma hadn't been over to play all summer. And so they were sitting at the table with Monopoly board spread right in front of them. His palms are sweaty. His heart is beating rapidly. He's nervous. And Johnny says, I can still remember. It happened at Marvin Gardens. See, you're all Monopoly players out there. Here was the woman who had raised my mom. She loved me as her own. And I destroyed her financially and psychologically. I took every dollar she had. I finally won. It was the happiest day of my life. I was giddy. I was heady with pride and joy. But then Grandma, she had another lesson to teach me. She said, "Well, Johnny, now that the game is over, it all goes back in the box." What? I didn't want it to go back in the box. I wanted to leave it out there as a permanent reminder of how great a player I was and my skill, my prowess, maybe bronze it perhaps. No, Johnny, now that the game is over, it all goes back in the box. Now please understand, it's not bad to play the game, to be really good at it. It's not bad to be master of the board. Johnny's grandma taught him how to win. But let's face it, in this life, there will always be more rungs to climb, more money to be made, more deals to pull off. And the danger is we forget what really is important, what really matters. Students, young people, they may think that the main thing, that the way the game is won is by getting better grades or by making first string in the orchestra, or by making the vast basketball or volleyball team, or getting elected to class president. But then there's graduation, and then there's the pressure to win at your job, and then there's the pressure to get promoted and to have enough money to feel safe. I pass somebody up in that journey, and I feel a lot of pleasure. Somebody passes me up, a stab of pain. And always, if we're really honest with ourselves, there's this inner voice that keeps saying, "Is it enough? Did I do good?" And sometimes if I'm really, really quiet, the voice asks this question, "Does it mean anything?" And here we are. Well-planned retirement communities where ginkgo biloba, Botox, Grecian Formula 44, and Lipitor and Viagra all bring these chemically induced temporary immortality. But then one day it stops. Others keep going. Did you play wisely? We all want God. But tragically, left our own devices, we seek all the worldly things first. Possessions, money, looks, power. Because we think that they're the things that'll bring fulfillment. But you know what? They're just on loan. They're not ours. You see, when the game is over, they'll go back in the box. I want you to turn with me for a minute to your scriptures or look up on the screen. Very well-known parable that Jesus told. There we go. Found in Luke 12. And he told them this parable: "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. And he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops.' And then he said, 'This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I'll store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be for whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God.'" Fool, that's some pretty heavy language, pretty harsh language. What is Jesus telling us here? This guy has simply devoted his life to the wrong things. Now, if you'd look at his list of priorities, it would look something like this. Harvest large crops. Now, I can tell you about harvesting large crops. I grew up in the plains of Saskatchewan, Canada, wheat farmer. My dad was a farmer and a teacher. And I can tell you a lot about crop failure. But if a farmer had a bumper crop, oh boy, that went a long way down the road. And of course, up in Canada, you could be 2 days before you get out there with the combine to harvest the wheat, and here comes a hailstorm, boom, 100% loss. So this guy, he harvested these large crops, he built bigger and better barns, he achieved financial security, eat, drink, be merry, but remember not to die. And that last one is the hard one. But let's look at verse 20 again. And the things you have stored up, whose will they be? Do you get that picture? I can honestly tell you, friends, that probably some of the most distressing and some of the most difficult times in my 40-plus year of ministry was those heartbreaking moments after a funeral, when the family would start getting at odds with each other. Who's going to get this and who's going to get that? Whose will they be? This is the same realization that tormented King Solomon. You can read it in Ecclesiastes 2:18. I hated all the things that I had toiled for under the sun because what? I must leave them to the one who comes after me. You see, here's the reality. That executive, that successful businessman, that workaholic who works from 6 a.m. in the morning to 9 p.m. every night will be both very successful and fondly remembered by his wife's next husband. Funerals. Way, way too many of them in the last few years. There's a book, believe it or not, that was written about funeral rituals. You know, the foods and the customs from different cultures all around the world. It's very interesting reading. The book is entitled Death Warmed Over. And the author, Lisa Rokak, tells a story of a man who's dying at home. He knows his days are numbered. And he's up there in his bed, lying, you know, just aching from head to foot. And as he's up there dying in his bed at home, he smells the aroma of fresh chocolate chip cookies wafting up from the kitchen. Ah, his favorite. Wow. And he thinks to himself, oh, my dear wife, bless her heart. How thoughtful. She knows that I wanted just one more cookie before I die. And so he drags his body out of bed and he rolls literally down the stairs, crawls into the kitchen on all fours, and he reaches out his trembling arm and hand to grasp one more of those fresh, warm cookies when he feels the sting of a spatula on the back of his hand. Whack! Put them back. They're for the funeral. True story. You see, the fool had many cookies, and he thinks they're all for him. And this is what I'll do, the fool says. I'll tear down my barns and I'll build bigger ones, and there I'll store my grain and goods. One more barn. One more crop, one more cookie, then one night, out comes a spatula, and whack. They don't belong to you. They're for the funeral. To borrow a well-known phrase, ask not for whom the spatula whacks, it whacks for thee. But you see, when Jesus told this story, he summed up in one sentence, one single sentence, the object of life, the purpose of life, the main thing of life. I don't care if you're in elementary school or high school or college or you're a retiree. Every person that has ever lived in one way or another has asked this question. What is the meaning? What is the purpose of life? Why am I here? What's the main thing? And Jesus uses one single sentence to make sure that no one misses the point. So here it is. You're going to take one thing with you from this message this morning. Here it is. So it is for everyone who accumulates riches for themselves and is not rich toward God. The object of life is breathtakingly clear right here. Don't spend your life playing master of the board. It's a sucker's game. You can't beat the house, but you can be rich toward God. Your life with God's help can be a source of pleasure to the God of the universe. I mean, I'd love to think of this, that my life, our lives, can actually make God smile. The smiling God. We don't think of him very often in that way. But you can be the instrument that God can use to share the good news of the risen Savior. That's what the gospel is all about. That's what the gospel is. For you see, friends, when that final day comes, when the game is over, all that will matter will be God's assessment of my life. Venture capitalists, Elon Musk and his billions, Hollywood stars, National Football League basketball players, overpaid celebrities, school janitors, that Somalian tribesman, the poverty-stricken Haitian, the Ukrainian and Russian refugees, the waitress at Denny's. On that great day, they will all stand in line before him on level ground. And it'll not make one iota of difference how much stuff you've accumulated in this journey. Now, I'm talking to myself this morning. Stuff. Whew. 35 years ago, if you'd have had an insight, if you'd have been an entrepreneur and invested in an industry that now is a multi-billion dollar industry, it's these you store it facilities. You know, you've seen them. Some of you probably have one. You know, you get to take the stuff that's no room in your house and you store it. You know, you got visitation rights. You can swap it out whenever time you want. Stuff. When Judy and I moved here to Sun City West permanently 4 years ago, we sold our home in Paradise, California, just 4 months before that fire took the entire city. 14,000 out of 15,000 homes. But as we came to the realization, we had a little place here in Phoenix that would come in the wintertime, and at this stage of my life, less is more. And so we said, let's downsize. I'm still working on that one. We're still working on that one. So I take several loads of stuff to the dump. Now they call it a landfill these days. Sounds way, way, way more, you know, earth friendly, a landfill. It's a dump, okay? And here it is at the dump. You got stacks and stacks of old tires. You got one section over here, all these old appliances, stoves and refrigerators. And you got stacks and mountains of bicycles, you know, that the owner's too lazy or not smart enough to fix. And so here they are. And then over here they have all the electronics. And I can still remember this guy backs up his pickup and he's got one of these monster television sets, not a flat screen, not a HD, you see, it's not good enough. You gotta be, you see, in this culture we live in, you better get it bigger, better, and faster than the other guy. And says, this is not bigger, better, and faster. I got to get rid of it. This thing worked fine. So he's got another guy helping him, and they're dumping this stuff. And I'm thinking to myself, that big television, that velvet painting of Elvis, and all this other stuff that's getting dumped was at one time bigger, better, and faster than the other guy. But friends, the enemy has established a hamster wheel. It never ends. You just keep running. You just keep running. The bigger, better, faster stuff. I pulled into Walmart here a few days ago, and I thought, man, are we having an earthquake? My car was shaking. And then I realized that a couple of cars down, there was a little kid in a lowrider, and he had these monster speakers in the back of his trunk. The big bass, you know, it was shaking my car. And he had these tires that were, you know, illuminated. He had more money in his stereo system and his tires than he had in his car. But for that kid, that was the main thing. On a flight a few years back, and I read a tagline in a magazine, and it said this: yesterday, I didn't know it existed. Today, I can't live without it. That's the culture in which we live. I think back to a few years ago, and my wife and I, we were visiting a lot of churches and doing work for Quiet Hour Ministries, and we had a few days off, and we were in Central California. We decided we want to go to a tourist stop that we hear a lot about, and I guarantee a bunch of you have been there. Central California along the coast, we wanted to go see Hearst Castle. And so we went. How many of you have been to Hearst Castle? Oh, okay. Whew. I mean, it is unbelievable the amount of stuff that Randolph Hearst accumulated. I mean, he has statues and stuff from ancient Greek, you know, paintings, collectibles, unbelievable. But something interesting happened. As we stood on the step, as we exited, here comes a mom and a dad and little kids. And the mom turns to her children, and she looks around and goes, wow, he sure had a lot of stuff. He sure had a lot of stuff. Now, I don't know about you, but the last thing I want people to say about me when I go is, wow, he sure had a lot of stuff. Winston Churchill, he put it pretty plainly. He said, we make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give. And I am so grateful that I belong to a church family that gets this. There's some of those generous people in the world that understand that we're here just temporarily. And there's something a lot better beyond. There's only one thing that we can take with us from here to eternity. People. The only eternal commodity in this journey are people. But isn't it ironic that many, many spend most of their time and their resources and their abilities on the temporary, the stuff that doesn't last? Now, please understand this. There's a huge difference in having riches and being rich. There's a huge difference in having wealth and being wealthy. My wife and I, we've had the joy of doing over 50 short-term mission projects in countries all over this world. And I can tell you this right now, we have met so many people that are some of the richest and wealthiest people in this world, but they don't have two dimes to rub together because their riches are deposited in the bank of heaven and their interest will be paid throughout eternity. That's where their richness and that's where their wealth is. But I'm going to just tell you this. God also has people who are not only materially wealthy and rich, but they're also spiritually wealthy and rich, who do incredible things for God's kingdom. I'm going to pause right now. Many of you are aware that our family has adopted a ministry where we're doing, in fact, you won't be seeing much of us for the next few months because we're going to be visiting about a dozen churches in the Northwest every Sabbath at a different church to share with people what a ministry that is really, really making an incredible difference in introducing people to Jesus. It's a gospel outreach ministry that, by the way, did any of you, a few of you already contacted me, did any of you tune in 3 weeks ago Saturday night to the concert our family did at Loma Linda University Church? Oh, I see quite a few. If you haven't seen it, it's worth going to YouTube or the Loma Linda University Church website and watching it. But I got a question for you this morning. Are you ready to experience what it means to be rich toward God? Well, many say, oh, you wouldn't get me on stage to preach or to share my testimony. I'm not a singer. You know, don't do that. I'm not very talented. Well, here's the deal. Let me assure you this. God is not impressed at all with your abilities. Man is impressed with your abilities, but God is impressed eternally with your availability. You make yourself available, say, God, here I am, use me. I mean, whatever this little earthen vessel can do, I give you permission to use me. That, my friends, is what being rich toward God is all about. But it's amazing how the enemy of our souls distracts us, gets us sidelined, gets all hot and bothered over stuff absolutely nothing to do with people's salvation. Let me tell you what, I don't care what pastor comes into this church or whatever pastors are out there, it just seems like it never ends. Let me give you an example. Pastor, a friend of mine, we were in a pastor's meeting together, and he was just scratching his head. He was troubled because his church was going through a remodel experience. Now, if any of you have been through that, you have my sympathies. But you see, in this church, this half of the church wanted blue carpet, and this half of the church wanted green carpet. And the blue carpet people had outgiven the green carpet people, and now they're at war with each other. And the enemy just sits back there clapping his hands, knowing he is paralyzed. He has neutralized God's people for just foolishness. But you fill in the blank. I remember one of the churches that I pastored. Here's the big issue in the board meeting. We're renting our fellowship hall to the AA. Alcoholics Anonymous. And, you know, brothers, it's requiring extra janitor service. It's requiring, I mean, they're eating and there's food on the floor. And, you know, there's some liability issues here. And then some of them after the meeting, after the AA meeting, they're going out to the parking lot and they're smoking. Ooh. And it's costing us more money for the utilities. You know what message comes through with that? Stuff is more important than people. I'm going to tell you what, that vexes my spirit. That's what the enemy does. And you can fill in the blank. I don't know the history of this church, but I guarantee you there is some event that has happened that has sidelined us, that has got us distracted from the main thing. When people come to that stage in life where they have to drop their last will and testament, usually their last words are their most important desires for what happens after they go back into the box, after the resurrection. That glorious resurrection weekend, Just before Jesus goes to heaven, he gives his disciples his last words and testament. This was their assignment. And he tells them, go everywhere in the world and tell the good news to everyone. That was it. And again, he repeats those words so that no one could miss their importance. He said these words on the hillside of Galilee to all those believers who had gathered together, not just his disciples, and the Desire of Ages fits such a beautiful picture. Standing around in small groups on the hillside, these followers of Jesus were eager to learn all that they could from those who had seen Jesus since his resurrection. The disciples moved from group to group, sharing what they had seen and heard personally. Suddenly, Jesus is standing in the middle of that crowd. What? He's with us. This is the only time where it is recorded that he talked with most of his believers after his resurrection. And his words, coming from the lips that had been sealed in death, thrilled their hearts. His sacrifice for humans was complete. His work on earth was finished. And then we read his final words, his last will and testament, where he says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. I'll be with you always to the very end of the age. Friend, that's it right there. That's it. That's the main thing right there. And as I shared just a minute ago, that's one of the reasons why our family is so committed and excited to be voluntary, ambassadors for gospel outreach. And some of you that may not know about this ministry, we got some brochures in the back that we can hand out to you. But this is an all-volunteer organization located up in College Place, Washington. And if you notice anything about these volunteers, is that my phone? I hope not. All of these people have one thing in common. Can anybody identify what that one thing is? They're all geezers like us. These are all retired teachers and physicians and hospital administrators and conference presidents. And in fact, Ken Crawford, who attends this church when they're here during the winter, he's the president, he's a board chairman of this organization. And this organization is all volunteer. They have zero full-time employees. This organization targets the 1040 window. That's that area 10 degrees north to 40 degrees north latitude in the Eastern Hemisphere. That's North Africa, the Holy Land, India, Indonesia, China, to the Philippine Islands. This is where two-thirds of the world's population live. It's one-third of the world's landmass, but yet 97% of the people who have not heard about Jesus, that's where they live. And the tragic part of that whole story is 2% of Christian churches' evangelistic efforts go there. We keep plowing. We've done a pretty good job of the rest of the world. In fact, there's enough money spent on evangelism every year, we could reach the world several times. But we keep plowing the same ground over and over and over again, hoping for different results. I'm going to tell you this. I wish I could get in the face of every conference president, and if you're listening to me, take these words seriously, every evangelist, every church worker in North America, U.S. and Canada, and basically tell them this: for every dollar we spend here in America, we need to spend an equal amount or greater in that region of the world where people are starving to hear about Jesus. The words of Paul. By the way, the Apostle Paul, he's number one on my hero list. And he's one of the guys I'm going to go look for first after I cast my crown at the feet of Jesus. I'm going to go look for Paul. I got to talk to that guy. Every Bible, or most Bibles, have in the back, you know, the maps and the description of his missionary journeys, where he went, all this planet. After his third missionary journey into Rome, I mean, this guy was shipwrecked, he was beaten, he was imprisoned. I mean, you can't believe, Paul and Silas, I love that story. You know, middle of the night, the chains fall off. Incredible story about Paul. Paul comes back after his third missionary journey, and here's what he says. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Wow, that's good news right there. Thank you, Jesus. But then here he has a fourfold anxious moments, questions. But how can they call on him unless they believe? And how can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? You get that? That's what Gospel Outreach is doing. They're sending these indigenous Bible workers into that region of the world where a Westerner like you and me, if we showed up, we wouldn't last 2 minutes. I have to be careful what I share with you this morning because our social media grabs stuff and puts some of these Bible workers in danger, puts them at harm's length. But what is happening in the 1040 window right now? We have in 52 of the 70 countries there, we have indigenous Bible workers. These are Bible workers that already know the language, they already know the traditions, they know the culture. They've raised in these little villages, they know the people. I didn't have this in my notes, but I'm going to just break away. I can still remember I was about 12 or 13 years old. Sitting in the primary tent there in South Lancaster, Massachusetts for camp meeting. And I don't remember what returned missionary it was, but we loved to hear these stories from the missionaries who'd come back from wherever it was, and they would tell real life stories. I mean, you're talking about miracles and things that are happening were just amazing. But even in my little simple 11, 12 year old mind, this thought occurred to me when I heard one of the missionaries say, you know, we've been in this country for, you know, 8, 9, 10 years, and we're just starting to learn the language, and we're just starting to understand the culture and the traditions and the people. And in my little mind, I thought, you know, Lord, don't you have some locals? Don't you have some indigenous people here that already understand the people and they understand the language and the culture? That is exactly the reason Gospel Outreach was started. An amazing organization. They're the ones that are sending out these missionaries, these Bible workers. Right now, there's 2,200 Bible workers in that 1040 window, 52 countries. And here's the beautiful part about Gospel Outreach. They have no full-time employees. It's all volunteer. They have a couple of part-time that do the internet and so forth. So their costs are less than 5%. 5%? There's absolutely no ministry in the church. Most of the ministry that you and I are familiar with, and we love them all, Voice of Prophecy, God, you know, Quiet Hour, It Is Written. But most of those ministries, they function on at least 40 to 50% overhead for administration. 5%. So that means 95 cents of every dollar goes to these Bible workers. And these Bible workers, in the 25 years that Gospel Outreach has been in existence, they've had over 1.5 million baptisms. Can you say amen, praise Jesus? Of course. The reality is this. The great mission advocate Oswald Smith said this: no one has the right to hear the gospel twice while there remains someone who has not heard it once. And this is where Gospel Outreach is really serious about sharing Jesus in those regions. We have just a couple minutes before the clock is, before your beepers are going to start going off and the 12 o'clock alarm is going to go off. But let me tell you about an example of what God is doing in these regions of the world. There's three very, very well-known countries that have been in the news a lot over the last, you know, how many years we've been at war over that part of the world. I guess I can say it because those countries, they already know that. Afghanistan, Iran, and Iraq. You can't count the number of converts that are saying, we want nothing to do with that radical religion that we belong to. We need something else. And they're being baptized by the tens of thousands. It's unbelievable. In the 1040 window right now, throughout that region, there are 150,000 Seventh-day Adventist Muslim home churches. Now, I don't know where the Amen corner disappeared to, but did you just hear me? Now, you don't get these numbers in the Review or an Adventist today. These things have to be very careful who you share this with. 150,000, say the average, you know, attendance is 8 or 10 people in a home church. That's millions. Friends, Jesus is coming back soon. And I want to make sure that all of us here keep the main thing in our journey. Quick story, then I'll do a song and we'll close. So in one of these countries, and this is a country I can't mention, because in this country already many of our Bible workers are in prison. They're being sought after. They got basically a target on their back. But in this particular country that claims to have religious freedom, and they point to the big churches that the government has built, they say, yeah, you know, the Adventists work here, worship here, and the Baptists and the Pentecostals, we have religious freedom. What they don't tell you is that the government requires those pastors to submit their sermon notes 6 weeks in advance, and every one of those words are read by the minister of religion in that country. And if anything is said derogatory about the government or about what's going on in that country, about, you know, human rights, they're gone. So the home churches in this particular country, very, very large country, a lot of people. So home churches is how the work is growing. And so here in this particular country, there are many, many of the ministers, the leaders of the church are women. The men are outlawed to be involved in ministerial work. So this one dear lady, she calls in some carpenters and she says, I need to have my kitchen remodeled. Oh, really? And what do you want us to do? I want you to tear up the floor, raised foundation, and I want you to put a soaking tub right here in the floor. In the kitchen? Yep, that's what I want. Okay. I want it about 3 feet wide, about 6 feet long, about 3 feet deep. All right. Friends, in that little home, in the last 3 years, over 600 people have been baptized. That's just one little home church. I don't know about you, but it kind of puts me to shame. I've got it easy. We've got it really easy here. I mean, look at the freedoms that we take for granted. Look at the freedoms we've lost in just 2 years. I won't go down that road, but whew, mercy. You know. So I want to close with a song that is one of my favorites. Let's do it.
Cross Jesus built.
so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. With only three nails and two pieces of wood, with a rugged cross, Jesus made a way. Jesus built a bridge, the only way he could, so we could live in glory land someday. The Father's hand of grace touched the earth below, on that hill called Calvary that day. There he left his love for every mortal soul. He still is here and never goes away. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. No matter where you are, you can return to the Father's house today. There is always a way. Jesus built a bridge you cannot. The door, but he is here with open arms today. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. No matter where you are, you can return today. There is always a way. Jesus built a bridge you cannot burn. To the Father's house today. Jesus built a bridge. Lord, all I can say this morning is thank you. We just can't say that the peace and the joy and the assurance we have in knowing that you're coming back again to rescue us from this ball of mud, this world that's so evil and full of wickedness and deception. And Lord, we know that in this journey, there's so many things that we but are of value and are just temporary. But Lord, help us to take serious that the main thing you want from us is to be salt and light, to be able to share Jesus wherever it is, however we can do it. If we can help support one of these Bible workers or the neighborhood Bible study, we can introduce people to our loving Savior, the one who died on Calvary and whose tomb is empty. Lord, for this church family, I just want to say thank you for them, for their witness, for their example, for every family represented here this morning, for these young people, these kids that we just love them so much. Lord, help them to get a glimpse of our loving Savior, Jesus Christ. As we begin another week, we give this week to you. And again, Lord, we just open ourselves up and say, we give you permission to use us. In whatever capacity, Lord, please use us for your honor and glory. So now as we depart, just pray that you would give us a safe journey home. And for our fellowship together today, we are so grateful, Lord, that we can meet again and hug each other and just know that we are in a fellowship with kindred spirits. We love you, Lord. We give you all the praise and glory, and all God's people said together. Amen. Praise God.